As Christians, we recognize that our beloved country is in turmoil and needs a spiritual reawakening, the kind that leads to true repentance and genuine revival.
Jesus said very specifically, go and make disciples of all nations. But we have to begin first in our Jerusalem.
It's not one individual's responsibility, it's the church's responsibility.
The church needs to leave the building to go to the city.
And I guess another way to say it is it's harvest time. I mean, you're ignoring the obvious if you don't see it's harvest time.
Saturate USA is a God-sized vision that seeks to take the love of the gospel to 60 million families and homes by the end of 2020, with the goal to help the church ignite repentance and revival in this country.
I do believe it's possible to see every home reached in a city because I believe it's the heart of our Father, and so nothing's impossible for Him.
This is a vision that's helping bring the body of Christ together in ways that can only be described as divinely inspired.
It can be done in America.
And the time is now.
This can be accomplished as long as we're obedient. Once you say go, you go.
Christ for All Peoples is helping thousands of local churches reach their nearest mission fields with free evangelistic materials, including multi-language Jesus film DVDs.
The Saturate model, I think, is excellent.
I'm like, wow, this sounds like what I love to do, this evangelism.
It's exciting to me because it's not just one organization doing it.
They're blessing the local congregations where they're coming in with a heart to serve rather than be served.
The Saturate process is simple. Anchor churches receive deliveries of DVDs and materials and mobilize volunteers to assemble thousands of packets with creative tracks, DVDs, in each church's information. Participating churches then come together to pray, receive neighborhood maps and packets, and go into communities to distribute to homes.
It was very refreshing to hear them say, God's already provided the funds for this. We just need the hands and feet.
This has provided the money, the resources to release what the heart is of these different local churches.
And each of us gets our own ownership of it, that we can communicate with the people in our communities, something that one organization or one church could never do across a whole city, to be able to be that personal with individuals, to meet their needs and also personally connect with them with the gospel.
God is moving today. I think I have some perspective, having been at ministry for many years, and I can tell you more's happening today than was happening 50 years ago.
God is pulling His body together.
Well, this is the work of the Holy Spirit.
It will come to fruition. It will touch lives.
Our country needs to rediscover the message of the gospel, and we need to cry out in prayer for revival to sweep our land.
And it's thrilling to my heart to see the synergy.
We can do it as a team, as we join hands and heart with other churches and other brothers and sisters.
And we're communicating the gospel. We're doing it together, and we're uniting for the sake of Jesus Christ.
United in love, and with God on our side, one city at a time, we can win America back to Christ. Find out how you and your church can get involved in bringing the Saturate USA movement to your city. Sign up now at saturateusa.org.
Good morning. Good to see each and every one of you here today as we come to worship in the house of the Lord. And what a glorious day that this is. And we're looking forward to our time together and wanting to exalt the wonderful and the precious name of Jesus, the name that is above every name, where everything in heaven and things on earth and things under the earth shall bow their knee and confess to God the Father that Jesus Christ is Lord. So we're grateful that you have chosen to be in the house of the Lord today, and we're looking forward to seeing what God's going to do in our midst. The video today about Saturate is about the church coming together and engaging our communities with the gospel. And so this, we're trying to get this set up for the first week of October. And if you would be willing to be one of those that would take that DVD and information about our church, and also to engage with people, to pray with them, to be a witness to them, then there is a sign-up slip or a sign-up thing on the bulletin board behind me in the center hallway. We'd like for you to sign up for that. So we're going to try to do that There's 600, I think it was 665 homes in Tar Heel. And so we want to be able to connect with each and every one of them with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have done this, I have done this before, back in Reedsville, and we passed out, seemed like to me it was like 800 different packets to, and just hung on the doorknobs, and we talked to people and prayed with them. It is a very important ministry. So if you're willing to be a part of that, then we would ask that you sign up and let us know as we try to saturate USA with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Also, we'd ask that you'd also look at other things there in your bulletin, things that you would be interested in, things that you would want to be aware of, opportunities for you to participate. One of the things that I want to add to this is the 9/11 recognition service that's going to be this coming Saturday night, 7 o'clock at the Bladen County Courthouse. So if you want to participate in that, it's a special time of recognition for those who are in service and helping, putting their lives on the front line. Also, just to kind of give you a little bit of a heads up, next Sunday morning, we will have a time of recognition and appreciation for those that are here in our congregation, those who are among us that are on those front lines that are serving. We'll have a testimony next week by someone who has been there and experience the blessings of the Lord as a result of that. So we hope that you'll be here for that as well. So if you're a part of the fire community and fire department or law enforcement or medical field or even served in the military, we want to be able to recognize you because of all of these things. We had pledged years ago, 9/11, that we would always remember not only those that were fallen, but those who are continued to serve. So we want to be able to do that next Sunday. I know that there is still another event that we're hoping to be able to do sometime later this fall to provide an evening service of that similar recognition and to also have some refreshments for them. Also have a thank you note here, and it comes from Pansy Drew Zach. It says, "Give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, and shaken together and running over." Thank all of you so very much for all of the calls, the texts, the food, the ramp, cards, visits, and prayers since my surgery. You have truly been the hands and the feet of Jesus, and I will never forget the love that has been shown to me. Thank you all again, Pansy. So we're thankful that the Lord has blessed her and has her back with us today. As we continue to the Lord in prayer, we want to be mindful of those that are on our prayer list, continue to lift them up. I do want to let you know that Jeff Allen is at Cape Fear Hospital. They took him up there yesterday, this past Wednesday. He had had a procedure done on his sinuses and stuff, and it began to be agitated or something or another through the week, and they ended up put him in the emergency room yesterday. They admitted him. They're running some tests and stuff to find out all of what's going on with him. So continue to remember him and Teresa as they're going through this time. I'm sure they will greatly appreciate it. I'm sure today that as we come together, there are special needs in our life, burdens upon our heart, things that we desire the Lord to help us with, to give us wisdom and understanding and strength to be able to deal with all the things of life. Jesus says that in this world we shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. He's overcome. So we're looking to face him, to trust him in all of these things. So let us bow our heads together for this time, this season of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are ever so humbled before you, but Lord God, we are so glad to be in the house of the Lord today. We're so thankful, Lord, for the blessings that you have placed upon our life and that you have allowed us to meet together as one in your presence. And we pray, Lord God, your special blessings upon every heart and upon every life. We pray, Lord God, for all of the worries and the cares and the troubles that we have within our life. We bring before you and we place them at your feet, trusting you and asking you, Lord, that you would help us. asking you, Lord, that you would empower us, asking you, Lord, that you would strengthen us to be able to stand up to the task and to be able to accomplish that which only you can do in and through us. So, Father God, today I pray that there would be a great ministry and a work of your Holy Spirit in our hearts and our lives that would bring us to that perfect peace, that would bring us to the joy and the fulfillment of the glory of the Lord in our hearts and our life. Today, we do bring before you all of those that are on our prayer list, the sick and suffering. We ask you for your healing touch, and for those who are the caregivers, we ask your blessings upon them. We also pray, Lord God, for the families that have lost loved ones, and we ask you that you draw them ever so close to you in their time of need, and that you would help them to learn to lean upon you each and every day. We also pray today, Lord God, that you would bless those that are dealing with those special and hardships that you have designed in their hearts and their life. We pray that you would help them to see their way through. We also pray, Lord God, for those that are lost and undone without Christ. As we think about the opportunity to saturate USA, we ask you, Father, that we would have an army of people, people whom you have touched and have they have experienced the redemption through your precious blood, that they would step up and that we would be able to carry the gospel out in this sin-infested world, and that there would be people saved and lives forever transformed. So, Father God, we pray for that ministry right now and ask you that you would bless us to be able to do that. We also pray, Father God, today for those that are having other burdens upon their heart. They may be relational, it may be financial, it may be physical, whatever it may be. Lord God, we know that whatever is above our head is still under your feet. Lord God, we thank you and praise you for all that you have done. We also pray today, Lord God, for those that are down in the Gulf Coast in the region of this hurricane that has just recently passed through. We know, Lord God, that that causes a lot of devastation and heartache and depression and discouragement. But Lord, I pray that even in the midst of the darkness of their life, that you would send the great light, that there'd be many people who would be willing to make sacrifice of their time and their energies and their resources to be able to meet the needs right there with your great love. We also pray, Father God, for the situation within our militaries. We think about those fallen soldiers over in Afghanistan, as well as other lives that have been taken. Lord God, there's evil present all around us. And we just pray, Lord God, that there would be a mighty movement of your spirit, and that there would be a peace that would come. But Lord, we know that only way that that's probably going to ever take place would be that after the rapture of the church in this world goes to that terrible tribulation and enters into the great millennium. But Lord God, even so, we ask you that your blessings would be upon us. We know, Lord, that one day you're going to come and split that eastern sky. We know, Lord God, that one day you're going to call us up and we're going to be with you forevermore. So, Lord, bless us today. Bless this time that we have a fellowship and worship together. And we'll give you all the praise and the glory. For it's in Jesus' name, for his name's sake, we humbly pray. Amen. As we come to the Lord this morning to worship in song, we're going to do that. We're going to start off with I Stand Amazed. And the amazement of the Lord is that God loves us so much and that he wants us to be a part of his family. And that through his grace and his mercy, we can enter into the joy of the Lord. We have the great anticipation and the expectation of his return and our eternal home to be with him. What a joy. We have so much to celebrate today. So God bless each and every one of you as we celebrate through the ministry of music. Let us stand together.
Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me. me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Savior's love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love. See my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. When all I see is a cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
You may be seated.
It is well.
children ages... Oh, wait.
Let me take care of that. All right, before Children's Church leaves out, I do have an announcement that I need to make. I should have made it earlier during the announcements, but I'm going to do it now. We have a need in our church family to be able to divide the Children's Church up into two groups. It'll be from the 3 to 5 year old and then the 6 and 7 year old. There are several reasons why we're doing that. I don't need to get into that right now, but still, nonetheless, we would like to, if the Lord blesses you and speaks to your heart and you want to be a part of this for one Sunday out of the month, if you could possibly be a part of that children's church ministry for the 3 to 5 year olds. The 6 and 7 seems to be taken care of, but 3 to 5 year old is the area we need. So if you would like to volunteer and be a part of that ministry, like I said, one Sunday out of the month, if you'll get up with Jimmy Allen, or you can get up with me, either one, so that we can get that to make that happen. But we really need that to happen. So if you're willing to help with that, please pray about it and do what the Lord wants you to do. Now, Children's Church, you're dismissed. We do have a class for the 3 to 5 year olds as well as the 6 and 7 year old. So if you want to leave now, you're welcome to do that. Okay, we're looking at Matthew's Gospel, chapter 14. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 14. And I'm wanting to share with you a message from this passage of Scripture. Are you walking on water? Are you walking on water? If you have a copy of the Word of God and a physical label, please stand with me in the reading and the reverence of God's holy Word. Matthew 14, beginning with verse 22. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up to a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit." And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee on the water." And he said, "Come." And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink. He cried, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him up and said unto him, "O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" And when they were coming to the ship, the wind ceased. And when they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, "Of a truth, thou art the Son of God." Let us pray. I pray, dear Father, today for everyone that is before me, everyone that is under the sound of my voice, for those that may be listening online. We pray, Lord, for them as well. We ask you for whoever may watch this video later on, that this message here would be a blessing to their heart, and that they would be inspired, encouraged, and challenged, and maybe forever changed. So, Lord God, today I trust you. I trust you, O Lord, in the power of your Spirit. I trust you, Lord, in the power of your Word. And I trust you, Lord, that you would do a work in and through me that only you can do. I pray, Lord, as I yield my heart and my life to you right now in full, as much as I know how to do, Lord, I pray, Father God, for your filling and anointing upon me, and that you would preach me. I pray, Lord, that you would guard my lips and the message that I preach, that I would speak nothing of amiss, but only thus saith the Lord. And I pray to God that as we come to the moment of decision today, that you'd be able to do a work in everyone's life, and that we would be able to leave here saying that it has been good in the house of the Lord. Lord, we love you so much. We thank you. We have been so blessed beyond measure. And we humble ourselves before you in submission, praying, thy will be done. We ask it in the wonderful and the majestic and all-powerful name of Jesus. For his name's sake we pray. Amen. Probably after reading this passage of Scripture and hearing the title of the message, you may possibly be thinking, Pastor, you must be crazy. Your comments or your thoughts might be, Pastor, your elevator is not going all the way up to the top floor. You may be saying even, Pastor, I believe your cheese has slid completely off your cracker. You may even think, Pastor, you must have fallen and hit your head on something. But as we gather together today, and as I have studied and prayed over this passage of Scripture so much this week, I have looked with great anticipation to be able to share this with you. But I want you to know that the question is valid, and I am absolutely serious. There is a spiritual application of this passage that should be evident in every believer's life. And if Jesus has called you, and you're living in obedience unto him, serving him in whatever capacity that may be, I want you to know that what he is doing through you is no less impossible for you to do than walking on water. Can I get an amen? Would you have any fear or any doubt of what I just said to being absolutely true? Because you see, over there in John's Gospel, chapter 15, verse 5, it is where the Lord Jesus Christ himself tells us that we are to abide in the vine and he in us. For without me, he says, you can do nothing. People cannot teach in a Sunday school class and expect the fruit of the glory of God to happen through them unless they are yielding to him, and it is what Jesus does through us that counts. And you cannot do that on your own. You just as well try to get out there on Cape Fear River behind the church here and try to walk to the other side. It's impossible for you to do without Jesus. We need to know that. We need to hear that. We need to understand that with all of our heart. Let's take a closer look into the passage of Scripture and see what is happening. In this past chapter, in this chapter that we are in right now, John the Baptist, the cousin of the Lord Jesus Christ, John the Baptist has lost his head. He has been beheaded. Jesus has just fed 5,000 men, not counting the women and the children. And the disciples had, and he did that with 5 loaves and 2 fish. Impossible. But yet, the Lord, it makes it all possible. And you see, after it was all over, the disciples had taken up 12 baskets full of the remains of all that was done. And folks, that is what our God is capable of doing. We also see that after the feast has taken place, Jesus sends his disciples over to the other side of the sea ahead of him as he sends the multitudes away. 7,000, 8,000, I don't know how many people there actually were there, counting women and children. We just know that there were 5,000 men, not counting the women and the children. So Jesus, he departed. He asked the disciples, he says, you go on ahead, go on to the other side ahead of me, and I'll catch up with you later, and I'm going to take care of these crowds. I'm going to send them home. I'm going to bless them, and they're going to go home and go their own way. So this is what is happening. This is what's taken place. Nothing, listen to this. I want you to hear this. Nothing happens in the Lord that is not without purpose. Jesus has a purpose for everything he does. It's not randomly, it's just not off the cuff that we would say that we're just doing stuff as it comes to us. That's not what Jesus does. He always has a purpose. There's a purpose in everything in our life. God is at work in our lives. He is doing something wonderful. We hear John's gospel, or Paul's letter to the Philippians. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, he says, "He that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Christ." God is always at work in our lives. So let us connect the dots of the passage of Scripture. Let us see how all of this comes together. And hopefully, at the end of this time that we have together this morning, that the power of God would be upon you and bless you with this message, and that you would understand and know how to walk on water. Look at the passage of Scripture. First of all, we think about the circumstances, and the significance and the sending of the storm. The significance of the sending and the storm. Like I just said, there is nothing that happens without a purpose in the Lord Jesus Christ. Look here in the passage, he says, "And straightway Jesus constrained the disciples." In other words, he urged them. He literally, in a sense, commanded them. He says, "You get in the ship. You go over to the other side," while he sent the multitudes away. Now, as we think about that just for a moment, why would Jesus do that? Why would Jesus send the disciples ahead of him and for him to cross over sometime after? Why not keep the disciples right there with him while he's sending the crowds away? Why don't he have them assist them in getting and departing and going their own way? But you say, why would it not have been that Jesus would say, "Well, you know, you stay here, I'll send them away, and then we'll all go over together. We'll all stay as one group." But you see, I believe that here in the passage of Scripture, that he wants his followers to know him with a deeper intimacy and to learn how to trust him. Now, I'm sure today, if I asked you to raise your hand and say that you were trusting in the Lord, more than likely, every one of you would probably lift your hand, and I would say that that would probably be true to a certain extent. We will tell you, we will say to people, "I'm trusting in the Lord," but how far does that trust go? Does that trust go just within the boundaries of our abilities, of our knowledge, of our understanding? Or do we know how to trust God beyond all of that? Because you see, I believe that the church often downsizes our God, the creator and sustainer of the universe, down to our ability of what we can believe we can trust. That's weak, amen. But I'm telling you, it's the absolute truth. And we're going to look at this passage of Scripture. We're going to see and learn more about it. So as he sends the disciples away, we see that Jesus doesn't leave right away. What does he do? The Bible says here in the passage of Scripture in verse 25, "And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain to pray, apart to pray, and when the evening was come, he was there alone." Jesus ascends to the mountain to pray. We need to know exactly who Jesus is. Jesus is the Son of God, and Jesus prays to the Father, who loves him with a love beyond what we could ever comprehend. It's a perfect love. It's the same kind of love that he has for us, and we can't comprehend that either. I have trouble at times just believing that God could love me so much when he knows everything that there is about me. When he knows how weak I am. When he knows how sometimes spontaneous I am. And that I do stupid stuff that does not honor him. And I wonder, God, how in the world can you ever put up with someone like me? But he does. I can't begin to comprehend it all, but I believe it and I experience it every day. I was riding a truck the other day with someone, and I was telling him about certain things that were going on. He says, "Preacher," he says, "I call that fog." Now, this is August. We've had some foggy mornings in August. used to be where I grew up, if you had a foggy morning, every foggy morning that you had in the month of August, it was going to snow that many times during the wintertime. If that's so, then Tar Heel is going to be covered this year. We've had a lot of foggy mornings. I got to thinking, fog. I said, fog? He said, yeah. Favor of God. I am all the time telling people when they ask me how I'm blessed and highly favored, and I am. I am. I have that fog. I have the favor of God upon me. But folks, listen, every child of God has that. Every child of God has the favor of God upon them. Not that we earn it, not that we deserve it. It's just a magnificent, uncomprehendable love of God. And Jesus went apart to pray to his heavenly Father that loved him ever so much. So Jesus prays. I believe Jesus is praying up a storm. I believe he ascended up to the mountain to pray to the Father, saying, Father, let's take these disciples of mine. Let's take these men that we have set apart for the purpose of growing and knowing me, and that are going to follow after me after the resurrection. Help them to grow in an understanding of who I am and who you are and what you want of them. So he prays up a storm. Now, look at the passage of Scripture. He says in verse 24, he says, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea. And if you go back over into the book of Luke, you'll find out that it was so many furlongs away from the shore, which would actually be about 3.5 to 3.7 miles. And we also see here in this passage of Scripture that it was during the fourth watch of the night, which would mean that it's in between the hours of 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. in the morning. Okay? Now we need to understand that there are 12 men in a boat. 12 men in a boat, and it has been anywhere from 7 to 10 hours they were out there rowing this boat, trying to get to the other side as Jesus had commanded them. Now, they were only 3.5 miles off of shore. Only 3.5 miles. In 7 to 10 hours with 12 men rowing a boat. Folks, that's nothing for 12 men to do. Nothing for 12 men to do. They should have well been on the other side. But there was a problem. There was something going on. There was a storm in their life. He tells us here in the verse passage of Scripture, he says in verse 24, he said, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, and it was tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. Have you ever had something contrary going on in your life? I mean, there's all the time, seems like something or someone that wants to stand in the way. You can't seem to be able to proceed forward because of this contrary thing that is happening in your life. And the storms, they come and they come, and we often wonder why. We wonder why all of this is happening. They were in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves because the wind was contrary. It was boisterous as it would be. How many of us have been in such a storm of our life? How many of us have seemed like everything and every attempt that we've ever had, that we just couldn't move forward and everything was going wrong? Can we say amen? We've been there, done that. We know all about that, right? But you see, the thing about that is that when that happens, that's usually where many people are willing to give up. That's where many people are willing to throw their hands up and say, I quit. They're not willing to face the challenge. They're not willing to move forward. They're not willing. They're just so difficult that it's hard, and they can't do it, and therefore there's no glory in it. So why try at all? A lot of discouragement, a lot of depression, a lot of things that are happening right here in our world, right here in our community, We're faced with these kind of challenges, and we don't know how we're going to ever move forward. And it seems like it just keeps getting worse and worse. But what is it we can do as children of God who has a Heavenly Father that has control over all things? What is it that the church can do? What is it that you and I can do as individuals? Let's think a little bit closer as we look in verse 25 through 27. The circumstances and the fears of the storm. The circumstances and the fears of the storm. Verse 25, he says, "And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea." Look here again. We go on and read. And he says, verse 26, "And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled." Would you imagine? Out there in the middle of the night, early in the morning, you've been rowing and trying to get forward, and these winds keep slapping you, the boat, and the waves are slapping the boat, and you're not getting anywhere, but you know that you have to keep going on. You can't possibly stop, because if you do, that's even more dangerous. So they're out there giving it all they got, and they look out across the water, and they see something, and they says, "Oh, wow, we're out here so far away. It's got to be a ghost." Now, I know the Bible says a spirit, but what is a spirit? It's a ghost, right? What do we call the Holy Ghost? Amen? It's a spirit. So then what they did, when they looked out across the water, they saw a spirit. They thought it was a ghost walking across the water. Folks, listen, I know that there are things that can seem to be compounding our life. I know that there are sometimes that things just come at us at a continual pace, and it seems like there's something out there that is scaring me to death. We're fearful. We're caught up in the moment, and we're wondering about what in the world is going to happen next. And when they saw that, they said in verse 26, "And when they saw that, they cried out in fear." Now, what did that mean? What does that look like? Just this past week, I think it was Wednesday. No, it was Friday. It was actually Friday afternoon. Friday afternoon. No, I'm sorry. Let me get my days right. It was yesterday. It was yesterday afternoon. Yesterday afternoon, Wanda and I were at the house, and Wanda was going to go out the back door. When I was in the kitchen. I was in the kitchen washing dishes, believe it or not. And I was washing dishes, and when she, and I didn't know what she was doing, but she opened up the back door, and she screamed. She went, "I can't do it," like she did it. I mean, you just can just imagine. But when she screamed, I didn't hear nothing crash. I didn't hear nothing fall, so I didn't do anything. I just waited. In about 5 seconds, she says, "Tommy." So I quit washing dishes, dried my hands off, and I went to see what was going on. She says, "There was a lizard that come in that door was this long." And I wanted to see this thing because I haven't seen the lizards this long. And she had her eyeball on her. It was under my computer desk at the back door. And I saw this thing, and it was about this long. And so I just reached and put something behind him, and he just kind of casually, he wasn't afraid, he just walked back out of the door. And I says, "Everything's okay now. He's outside. What's going to happen if he comes back in? We'll get him back out." But she screamed. But folks, listen, I believe these 12 men out there in the boat, when they saw the ghost coming across the water, something unimaginable, something they've never seen before, something that was fearful to them, they were crying out, "Oh, help us! Something's happening! We're drowning! Oh, it's terrible out here!" I believe they were crying out, and they were not holding back anything whatsoever. They were hoping somebody was going to come to their rescue. They were hard at getting nowhere. They were paddling for all they were worth. They were doing everything that they could, and it just wasn't getting anywhere. In their hopeless condition, they feared what they saw, and it was Jesus coming to them, walking on the water. Listen to what he says in verse 27. But straightway, Jesus spake to them. He heard them. I don't know how far away from the boat Jesus was, but I can imagine there was quite a distance when they recognized something's coming across the water. And Jesus heard him screaming. He says, don't worry, it's me. Don't be afraid. They heard the voice of Jesus. It was a familiar voice. It was something that they could calm their fears. Jesus gives them the assurance and helps them in their time of need. The storm, the waves, the wind, they were real. It was a dangerous situation that they were in. But Jesus calls them to peace because he is with us and for us. Now, that's one of the greatest things that every born-again child of God ought to take complete confidence in, to know that he is always... Listen, Jesus tells us, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So when you enter into a relationship with him, Jesus comes in to stay, brothers and sisters in Christ. He's always there. And you see, he knows our fears. He knows our troubles. He knows about our tribulations. And what we all need to do is just simply call out on the name of Jesus. I'm here. I'm here, he says. I'm right here. Don't be afraid. But then Peter, oh Peter. You know, Peter's famous for opening up mouth and inserting foot, okay? And these disciples, they knew Peter. I mean, they knew what kind of a man he was. They knew about all of his temperaments and all these things. They'd been with him for a while now. And Peter does the unthinkable. You could just imagine. You could just imagine these men in the boat. They've been rowing. They're tired. They're beat. These waves, I mean, there's just all of this is happening. We've been scared to death by what we see coming across the water. And now Peter, what in the world, Peter? Peter hears the voice of Jesus, and listen to what he says. Verse 28. And Peter answered him and said, now listen to this, Lord, if it is you, bid me to come. Bid me to come unto you on the water. How in the world would this kind of thought enter into the mind of Peter? Oh, he's a spontaneous individual. But listen to what he does. He calls unto Jesus, Lord, if it's you, you bid me to... Listen, he didn't get out of the boat and then start off to Jesus. He says, Lord, if it's you, you bid me to come, and I'll come on the water. He would not have dared gotten out of the boat unless he had heard from Jesus first. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Amen. Can I hear it? Okay, now I want you to stay with me because this is absolutely important. Absolutely important. He says, if it's you, bid me to come on the water. Now you can imagine the shock of such request from the others in the boat. You could almost hear, you say, Peter, you must be crazy. You know you cannot walk on water. Peter, don't you see how bad it is outside of the boat? Peter, don't you see how that you can't walk on this water? Peter, don't be a fool. Don't do it, Peter. But then, verse 29, Jesus hears a request, and this is what happened. He says, verse 29, come. Come. Now listen to what happens here. He says, and when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, if we do not have a vision of Jesus, then we dare not get out of the boat. But if you're a child of God, He has promised to always be there for us. Peter exercised faith upon the Lord's command, and he crawled out of the boat. And as he let go of the security of the boat, he walked by faith as right then and there, his whole world was about Jesus. Everything he saw, everything that was around him, the only thing that was in the eyesight of Jesus or Peter was Jesus. Lord, if it's you, you bid me to come, and I'm coming to you on the water. Now, this is also about a love relationship. You see, Peter had rather get out of the boat with these 12 men than be in the water with Jesus. That's where he'd rather be. Now, folks, listen, that's where all of us ought to be. That's where all of us should desire to be, is to be where Jesus is. Because that's always the best place to be. Oh, it's stormy. It's wavy out there. It's a lot of troubles out there. But you're always okay when you're with Jesus. So, for a brief moment, Peter, listen to this. For a brief moment, I don't know how long it was. I don't know how far away Jesus was from the boat. But when Peter crawled out of that boat, for a brief moment, Peter could do what Jesus is doing. Now, that just blesses my soul. Folks, that'll almost cause you to have a spell right there. Because you see, when you are focused on Jesus and you're following the commands of the Lord in your life, when you're trusting in His Word, this is His Word, folks. This is what God has given to us. And when we're trusting in the Word, we can do what Jesus can do. We're following after Him. We're walking in obedience to Him. And we are able to do what Jesus can do. These men are there criticizing, Peter, you can't do it. Don't do it. Don't get out of the boat. Man, you're going to drown. We also see here in the passage of Scripture, although there's this monumental victory, there's also a failure. Peter was walking on the water. The only thing he could see was Jesus, and he was headed that way. But then in verse 30 he says, but when he saw, no longer did he see Jesus, but he saw the wind was boisterous. That means it was strong. That was a strong wind. It might have been the howling of the wind across the waves. I don't know what it was. But see, he saw the wind and how strong it was. And he was afraid. Fear. Fear takes place of faith. When he saw Jesus, when his eyes were focused on Jesus, he had faith enough to be able to walk across the water to see Jesus. But when we're looking outside of the circumstances, when we see the raging storms around us, we begin to focus on that and we lose sight of Jesus and fear sets into our life. And what happened to Peter? He began to sink. He began to go down quicker than a bobber with a bass on the end of the line. He was sinking fast. But listen to me. His eyes regained focus on Jesus when it happened, and he cried out, Lord, save me. And what happened? Jesus was right there. He reached down with his hand and picked him up on the water. And then he gave him a loving rebuke. He said, oh, Peter, you're doing so good. I've never been more proud of you ever in all of your life. You were doing so good. Why did you doubt? Why did you doubt me? Why did you doubt? Why did you take your eyes off of me? Because, folks, every time we take our eyes off of Jesus, we're going to go down. We're going to go down. We can't help it. Because it's only when we're out there doing what Jesus can do through us that we'll ever be successful in obtaining our purpose, which is living for Jesus, which is living for Jesus. And every time we take our eyes off, we're going down. We're going down. The storms of life are worth it. Listen to this. The storms of life are worth it if it brings us to the feet of Jesus in worship. Look here in the passage of Scripture. Verse 32. When they were coming to the ship and the wind ceased, because Jesus controls the waves and the winds. He has all power. He has the ability to do that. When they got in the ship, all of the winds and the waves, they were gone. In verse 33. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. Ladies and gentlemen, I think about that. I think about the glory of the Lord through one person who was willing to get out of the boat. By faith, be obedient to the command of God. They got out of the boat in the midst of all of the circumstances, refusing to listen to people's opinions or go by the circumstances, and they just have their eyes on Jesus and they're going on. And there are few people who will ever experience the glory of God in such a way. The church, I'm just not talking about Tarheel, I'm talking about the church as a whole, is powerless because we keep trying to do things on our own. We try to do it upon what we think we can manage, what we can do, and we're not trusting God. Well, you say, preacher, I do trust God. But how far does that trust go? How far are we willing to go? Are we willing to step out of the boat and follow Jesus? Are we willing to move forward? Most people are like the 11 that stayed in the ship. They had rather stay in the boat than go to Jesus, who is walking on the water in the midst of the storm. It's I feel secure right here. I believe I can manage it right here in the ship. Oh, we'll just row. We'll just keep on going. But listen, the ship is not going anywhere. You're not making any headway. You'll never reach your purpose. You'll never be able to make your goal staying in the boat. There'll be no glory staying in the boat. It's harder to take chances. So people would rather stay in the boat and rely on their own power and their resources. We don't have to exercise or strain our faith to move beyond ourselves and our faith if we stay in the boat. But the ship goes nowhere. The waves and the wind, they are contrary and they're getting harder. And they're stopping you from where you want to be. Now, if we do not have a vision of Jesus, like I've already said, then don't get out of the boat. If you can't see and understand that Jesus is in the midst of the storm, if you don't have any recollection of that, and if you don't have any direction in your life, then you best stay in the boat. Because you see, all about walking on the water is if you're able to focus on Jesus. Now understand this, folks. I'm not talking about going out to the nearest pond or across this river and walking across. There is no purpose of that right now. There's no purpose. There's no glory. You will go down like a rock if you try to do that. But today is the first day, the church of the church year, where we have new people going into positions. And folks, they have to walk on water if we're ever going to see the glory of God take place here. And I don't care who you are or what it is that you do. You need to be able to get out of the boat. If we want to see the glory of God in your life, if you want to see the glory of God here in this church, if you want to see the glory of God here in this community, if we want to see it in this state, if we want to see it in the world, ladies and gentlemen, we got to get out of the boat. We got to focus on Jesus Christ. We got to listen to what He tells us to do, and we have to follow anyhow. Don't listen to the circumstance. Don't look at the circumstances. Oh, they're bad. Oh, it's hard. It's difficult. It's dangerous out there. But listen, when Jesus in the midst of it and you go to him, long as you keep your eyes on him, you're going to be okay. You're going to be okay. And it may happen. It may happen that on the way, we might get distracted. We might get sidetracked a bit. But then when that happens, we're going to go down. But listen, just like Peter did, when we understand we're going down, we need to just holler out on Jesus, oh, Lord, help me out. Do you know Peter walked on the water twice? He did. He walked on the water out to Jesus. Then he walked on the water with Jesus back to the boat. He did that. He made it safely. If you're a child of God, he has promised us never to leave us nor forsake us. So we need to get out of the boat. Let Jesus be the focus of your life and your ministry and allow him to empower you to do the impossible and get out of the boat. Walk on the water. Whatever circumstances or trials you face, Lord, if you're in this, bid me to come. Just show me in your word what you want me to do. And I'll do it. Get out of the boat and walk on the water. Today, whatever circumstances are in your world, and it's different for every one of us. You hear me? I understand that. The circumstances you face are different than the circumstances I face. But we have to face these circumstances knowing, as a child of God, God has purpose. There's nothing that happens that doesn't have purpose as a child of God. Romans 8:28 says, for all things, and that all means everything. And when we hear the word all, we think about what we can think of. But you need to understand that Jesus is even careful to be mindful of the immaterial things that we think that are so insignificant. You see, the Bible tells me that God knows how many hairs there are on your head. Now, why that's important to God, I don't know. But he tells me that all things are working together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. And folks, if you're a redeemed child of God, that includes you. And you can absolutely trust that God loves you so much. Oh, it might be a difficult time. It may be hard. It may be something that is wrenching your heart slap out of your chest. But still know that God is doing something in your life. And we just simply need to put our focus on him and obey him. Forget about the circumstances. Forget about what people tell you. As long as you have a word from God, you do what God wants you to do. And you'll be okay. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, if you've never come to the realization that you're a lost sinner walking in darkness, you don't have any hope, what's it all about anyway? It may be that today that Jesus is speaking to your heart. It may be that today, right now, he's knocking on your heart's door. And if you've never met Jesus, he's wanting to come in and be Lord of your life. So I would invite you to open up your door of your heart and say, Lord, very simply, right there where you are, say, Lord, I don't know about all this, but something is happening on the inside. And if it's you, Lord, by faith, I turn away from my old life, my way of doing things, of me being in charge, of going my way. I turn away from all of that. And I'm going to trust you, Lord. I'm going to trust what I heard from the Word. I'm going to trust you, Lord. I'm going to get out of the boat and I'm going to come to you. Just, Lord, if it's you, I'll open up the door and pray that you will come into my heart to be Lord of my life. I surrender my all to you. Now, folks, a simple prayer like that right there, meaning it with all of your heart, you can enter into eternal life. Jesus comes right in upon the invitation. And as you surrender your heart to Him, He is Lord of your life. And you can know what it is to walk on water. Church, listen to me here. We're different from the world. We're the redeemed. We are to demonstrate the power of God in our life. We can't do it in the boat. We can row all we can. We can try to devise all of these different things to do. But if we're still in the boat, it's not going anywhere. We've got to put our eyes on Jesus. Are you willing? Do you see Him? Do you hear Him? Right now, is the Spirit of God speaking to your heart, saying enough is enough? Trust me. Follow me. I'll be there to catch you if you fall. But come on out of the boat. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, I want to thank You so much for today. I thank You, Lord, for these that have gathered in this place for worship. And I pray, dear God, that Your word would be able to accomplish what You desire it to do. Lord, I pray that every born-again child of God, in whatever task that it is before them, maybe they have never stepped out of the boat, but I pray that today that Tar Heel would be of church walking on water. So Father God, I ask You, if there's someone here that's lost and undone without Christ, I pray that You had spoken to their heart and that they would be willing to surrender. If they need help with that, Lord, I pray that they would come forward and help. I will help them with that. But Lord, just whatever You want to do. And I pray to God that there'd be church folk here, whether they stay right where they are or whether they come to the altar, but they would commit their heart and their life to You, saying, Lord, I'm going to keep my eyes on You. I'm going to do and what I understand You call me and tell me to do, and I am going to be obedient because I desire to be where You are, doing what You do. So, Lord, may Your will be done in everyone's heart today. We ask it in the wonderful and the majestic name of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. As we sing this invitation hymn today, if the Lord has spoken to your heart, there's a need in your life, we have this altar here. You're welcome to come. You're welcome to come if you'd like. And if you don't feel comfortable with that, I understand that. I understand that. But listen, you need to hear the voice of God, and you need to do what He wants you to do. Whether it's for salvation, you pray that prayer like I prayed just a few moments ago. Believe it with all your heart. Surrender your life to Christ. And if you are a church member here, if you're part of the church redeemed, I don't care where you go to church, and you're willing to keep your eyes on Jesus and follow Him, then you make that commitment to Him today. You may, and I do at times, I do. Sometimes I lose sight of Jesus in the midst of all of the confusion, in the midst of all of the complaints and all of the things that are going on. It's easy to do that. But when that happens, I know where to call, because He's always there to pick me up. As we sing this invitation hymn, you do what God wants you to do. Let us stand together. Thank you.
have carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, my heart has been in your sights long before my first breath, running into your arms is running to life from death. And I feel this rush deep in my chest, your mercy is calling out. Just as I am, you pull me in, and I know I need you now. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. And I'll run to the Father again and again. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again and again.